Hello guys, welcome back to the session Object-Oriented Programming Part 2. In the previous session, we have looked at four different issues of functional programming. To just recollect, they are reusability, extensibility, maintainability and simplicity. In this session, we are going to look at object-oriented programming and how object-oriented programming addressed all these four issues. If you look at the diagram, what you see on the slide, the four corners represents the issues of functional programming: reusability, extensibility, maintainability and simplicity. Let's have a look at reusability. And the items inside this circle represents the object-oriented programming principles. All these supports object-oriented programming principles. For reusability, we address reusability issue using classes and objects in object-oriented programming. And we address the extensibility issue in functional programming using inheritance, aggregation and composition principles of object-oriented programming. Simplicity issue will be addressed by using abstraction, encapsulation and polymorphism principles of object-oriented programming. Obviously, when you address all these three issues, extensibility, reusability and simplicity, your code will become better maintainable. Let's get into the sample application and we'll see how reusability and extensibility and simplicity and maintainability are addressed here. Let's go back to the code. So in this session as also I have taken one sample application what I have used in the previous session. Again, this is product management or order management. Let's look at the first issue, reusability. If you remember, in the previous session, we have created one method, calculate total cost. Let's go there and look here, calculate using functional. So here we have used calculate total cost method and we also discussed how it was replicated or how it was copied into different web pages or web forms wherever we needed this functionality. Okay, now let's see how we are going to address this reusability issue in object-oriented programming. So before go and look into the code, you need to know two important aspects of object-oriented programming or two important components, or we can say these are heart of object-oriented programming. They are classes and objects. Class is nothing but a physical file where you write your code. Objects are nothing but runtime, or nothing but your life in real life. It is not visible to you. It is loaded into the memory basically. So class is your physical file in which you write the code. Object is runtime file which loads into memory during the execution of your program. Okay, good. Let's understand what is object-oriented programming. In functional programming, we write code in terms of functions and each function relates to one business requirement or set of business requirements. That's how you program in functional programming languages like C or C++. Whereas in object-oriented programming, everything will be in the form of classes and objects. Means every it basically resembles our real life. Everything or object or human being in real life will be represented in terms of classes and objects in object-oriented programming. Let us say I have a customer. This is one class in object-oriented programming. At runtime, it will become an object. If we take order, order is a class in object-oriented programming. Like this, each and everything or human being or any entity will be represented as classes in object-oriented programming. Now, let's come back to reusability issue and how we addressed here. So, in functional programming, we have created one method, calculate total cost, and we copy-pasted the same method in all the other pages wherever we required. So, we are having multiple copies of the same logic in multiple places, so which is difficult to maintain it. In object-oriented programming, how we transformed and how we coded, let's have a look. In object-oriented programming, we are using classes. So class, as I told, it is basically a template or a physical file which contains your object, your real world objects. Class. So I have a class, and class is represented by a keyword class, and this is the name of the class, class product. If you see, I have written the method calculate total cost in my class CLS product, and this is the same method. If you see, calculate total cost, and it takes parameters quantity and product. If you go to the functional programming, this is also same logic. So what I have done, I moved my method which gives total cost of quantity, product quantity and product cost to a class called CLS product. Now what I do here, in all the pages, I use this method to calculate total cost of products. Okay, let us see by executing this program. Before that, I need to make it as startup page. From this one, let us save it. Now let's click on start. Very good. Let's give quantity as 2 and cost as 3, and you know the total cost will be 2 multiplied by 3, it will be 6. Just calculate. See, under button click event, what I am doing here, I am reading product cost into the variable product cost, you see 3, and quantity. And after that, so now I have read both cost and quantity. After that, if we see, I have a class here. I created one class you just a couple of minutes ago, that is CLS product. In order to invoke the method in a class, we need to create an object. So that can be done by using the keyword called new. So now I have created an object of CLS product class, and if you see, now I'm calculating, I'm invoking the method calculate total cost, which is available in CLS product class. Okay, and to this method I'm sending quantity and product cost. Let's step in. Just click F11. See, now I have come to the class CLS product. Under that I have got the calculate total cost, which gives me the total cost by multiplying quantity and product per product cost. That's it. I have got the total cost of products and quantities. Now see how it can be reused. If If let us say I have another form, form 1, where I might need to use the similar functionality. Let's place one button and one two text boxes. Okay, this is my, don't worry about the UI. So this, let us let's go to the click event of button. You can create an object of CLS product, obj CLS product, new CLS product, and you need to create variables, or you can directly invoke the method obj CLS product dot calculate total cost. So you need to send product quantity and product cost here. So what I can do here, so you need to read it basically. So this could be a text box one, right? Let me look at the, yeah, this is text box one and text box two. Okay, now you can read them into variables. Integer quantity equal to convert to dot int 16, text box one dot test dot, that's it, you can say, and then integer cost, again you can say convert to dot int 16 and read the text box, product text box value here, text box 2 dot test, and then you can pass those quantity and per cost here. That's it. Now see how easy it is. I did not repeat the code. I did not repeat the code, calculate cost method code in form1.cs. Instead, I am directly able to use the method calculate total cost that is written in CLS product class. Like this, you can reuse the functionality that is written in the class file wherever you want in any web form in this application. Thus, we achieved reusability. Now see, if at all you need to make some change to the calculate total cost method, you can directly go and change only here. Let us say make some change as per business requirement. So you can make change here and it reflects each and every web page, because you need to make change only in one place, that is in CLS product class. Like this, we can achieve reusability in object-oriented programming. That's good. Now let's get into the next issue, that is simplicity. So here simplicity can be addressed by using abstraction, encapsulation, and polymorphism. In this session, we will look into encapsulation and abstraction, and we can explore these options, these principles using code. Now, first we need to understand what is abstraction. Let's get into the slide. What is abstraction? Can anybody tell me? Fine, we'll look into now. So what is encapsulation? Encapsulation hides the complexity. So what's the complexity we are talking about here? So complexity can be anything, your business requirement, or the code that is required to implement your business requirement, the code that is required to validate your data, the code that is required to call some other components. So in this particular example, we will take data validation. Let us say in the front end, in calculating total cost, I would like to make some data validation. That is, if the quantity is greater than 5, then give some caution to the end user, give some alert to the end user. If the cost is greater than something, then give some alert to the end user. So how you implement, generally, how you implement. So you go to the, let's go to a form encapsulation. So when you read quantity value, you will basically apply the data validation like this. You will read the data from the text box like this, and then you will write a validation like this. You see, if convert to dot int 16 of text quantity dot text greater than 5, then give an alert box called quantity exceeds the limit. So like this, you are writing basically these validations in the front end itself. Here the front end is form encapsulation. Let me show you in action. Let's click on continue. Sorry. Let me comment and show it. So basically, what you see here is in the front end itself, you have written the data validation. This is additional complexity to the front end because I have written my business logic somewhere in CLS product to calculate the total cost, but I am not taking the responsibility of data validation. I have given it to the consumer itself. So what happens here, your consumer needs to be knowing all the data validations as much as you know. So it is additional complexity or additional overhead to the end consumer. Here the end consumer is your user interface. So what you need to do, you need to assign this responsibility to the CLS product class itself, because this is the place where we are calculating the total cost. So we need to give this responsibility to the product class itself. In that case, you are hiding the complexity of data validation from the front end. See, when you hide the data validation complexity from the front end, you are using simply one statement to read the data from the text box and apply the data validation. Let's look into the code. Before that, let me show you the class what I am using. So earlier I have used CLS product class for to demonstrate encapsulation. I have created another class, that is CLS product encapsulation. If you see in the front end, if you see in the Visual Studio, this is the class I am using. Earlier I was using this CLS product. Now I am using CLS product dot encapsulation. In this, I have properties quantity, and then I have property per product cost. In the property, what I am doing, I have read the value of quantity from the text box, and if it is greater than some value, then throwing this message. This is the message what you have seen in the front end. You see, I have moved this piece of validation to a central location, that is CLS product encapsulation class. In the same way, I have moved my product cost validation to the property for product cost in the class CLS product encapsulation. So now my front end that is form encapsulation is not aware of any validations. We have hidden the data validation complexity from the front end. Let's run this and see. Let's give quantity as 3. See, when I give the quantity as 3, I have basically set the debug statement. That's why it has come here. You come to the statement set, and then quantity is not greater than 5, so came out. So let me disable debug points so that I can quickly show you that one, this example, and give cost as 5. Run it and then click calculate cost. See, 3 multiplied by 4 equivalent to 12, that is the total cost. So in this example, what we have done is we have moved data validations from the front end FRM encapsulation and to the file, to the class CLS product encapsulation. Thus we have hidden the complexity. We have hidden the complexity from the consumer. This is called encapsulation. We should not give unnecessary complexity to the consumer. Here we means API providers or business logic components or any class library or any class file which contains methods or features implemented. Okay, so if you see here in CLS product encapsulation class, I have got a quantity property which reads the quantity data from the text box, and also it checks if quantity is greater than, let's see what is that, the validation here what I have written is the quantity, if quantity is greater than 100, then return alert box. If quantity is less than 0, then don't return any alert box. Okay, let me check one more time. Delete all breakpoints and start it. Quantity, let's give quantity as 100. No, 101. See, quantity exceeds the limit. That is what we have written here. Here you can see this code is under CLS product encapsulation. If I give product cost 0, then see product cost is 0. Cost should be greater than 0. This is what we written in a CLS product encapsulation class. If product cost equal to 0. Okay, like this. Earlier these validations used to be in the front end itself here. Just see, yeah, here. Now all these validations are moved to CLS product encapsulation. So as per definition, encapsulation hides the complexity. Now we hide the complexity from the front end and moved it to the CLS product encapsulation. Like this, we need to implement encapsulation perfectly. When we implement that, our code will be much more reusable, and also it reduces the complexity for the consumer of your APIs or class libraries. So that's about encapsulation. If you observe, we also implemented abstraction here, but let's get into the slide and see what is abstraction, and then we'll come back to the code. So what is abstraction? Abstraction shows only what is necessary. Encapsulation means hiding the complexity that we see in terms of data validations. Abstraction shows only what is necessary. That means to the consumer, give him access what is absolutely necessary to him. Okay, what is that? Let us see. So in the consumer, if you see in the form encapsulation, what you have, what you need to, let us say, in the product quantity text box, this is product quantity text box, we are doing the validation, but that validation is in product encapsulation class, which contains one property. That property is quantity. So here I am doing the data validation. So your consumer is required to know only quantity, because from the consumer we can read the quantity and we can read the cost, and on the click of button, it can calculate the total cost by calling total cost property in, let's go to total cost property, so in total cost property, it is basically multiplication of your quantity and product cost. So consumer, like a UI here, is all required to read the data and send it to the method total cost, the property total cost here. It is not required to know what kind, how the validations are written, because those validations are moved to the CLS product encapsulation. So let's go back here, the quantity property, go to declaration. Okay, so if you see, the access modifier of quantity property is public, because it should be public, otherwise it cannot be accessed by the class front-end form encapsulation.cs. But inside inside the quantity property, I am accessing one more method, is quantity greater. Let's go to this method, is quantity greater. What it is doing, it is taking the quantity value that has read from the front end and making a comparison against 100. If quantity greater than 100, then return true. Do we need to make it available to the front end, that is consumer form encapsulation? No, because your goal in encapsulation is hiding the complexity. When we are hiding the complexity of data validation from the front end, why should we make it available to the front end? There is no need, because CLS product encapsulation is doing the data validation. In that sense, in that lines, we do not need to make this method available to the front end. Let us see if it is available or not. Go to form, go to this form encapsulation. If you see here, I have already created an object of product encapsulation. Let us try to access here. OBJ product encapsulation, just click dot. See, I do not have is greater than 0. Per product cost property I have, quantity property I have, total cost property I have, but I do not have the front end do not have access to the method is quantity greater 0. How I achieved it? So basically, I am making sure that only necessary properties or methods are accessible to the front end or the consumer. That means I have achieved abstraction properly here. So that's what abstraction, show only what is necessary to the consumer. So that is what I have done here. Consumer form encapsulation is only required to have access to the quantity property and quantity property and total cost property, which is multiplication of quantity and for a product. So I made them as public, so they are available to the front-end form encapsulation, and I made is quantity greater than method as private. That means when I make this quantity greater method as private, it is not accessible to the front-end. Thus, I have achieved or I have implemented abstraction. Guys, please remember, encapsulation means hiding the complexity from the consumer. Abstraction means show only what is necessary to the consumer. So here we have implemented encapsulation by moving data validation from the front end to the centralized location, a class CLS product encapsulation. By making this, by implementing this, we have hidden the data validation complexity from the front end form encapsulation. And we made the method is quantity greater, which is being used in quantity property. So we made this as private. By making this private, it is not accessible to the form encapsulation. So this is what making making only necessary properties or methods or any members available to the front end. Here it is a consumer. So we achieved both, we implemented both encapsulation and abstraction here. If you see here, abstraction is achieved through encapsulation. Abstraction solves the problem in the design side, while encapsulation is the implementation. See here, abstraction solves the problem in the design side. Abstraction can be implemented in many ways. One of the ways I have used here is using proper access modifiers. They are private, public, protected like that. Here I used private modifier to the method is quantity greater, and hence it is not available to the consumer, that is form encapsulation. And if you go to the encapsulation as well, I have written the same comments here, that is abstraction is achieved through encapsulation. Abstraction and encapsulation complement each other. That means when you are implementing proper encapsulation, I am sure you are implementing the abstraction, and vice versa. Okay. So these are object-oriented programming principles, very important. Abstraction and encapsulation, don't get confused. Encapsulation hides the complexity. Abstraction shows only what is necessary. Just remember this example. Encapsulation hide the data validation complexity or logic from the front end, keep it in a class file. Make the methods a private if they are not required to be accessed by the front end, that is the consumer. Like this, we implemented abstraction and encapsulation properly using object-oriented programming, and it solves the problems of reusability and simplicity. We will look into polymorphism and extensibility in the next session. Thank you very much. We'll see you in the next session.